statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that ye might turn that ye might do them in the land where ye go to possess it. Thou and thy son and thy son's sons, all the days of thy life, and that day and that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do that it may be well with thee, and that ye may increase mightily, as the Lord God of thy fathers hath promised thee, in a land that floweth with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy mind, and with all thy heart, and with all thy might. And these words which I commanded thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. And thou shalt bind them for a sign unto thy hand, and they shall as faultless be between thine eyes. And thou shalt write them upon the post of thy house and upon thy gates. And when thy son asketh thee in time to come, saying, What mean the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments which the Lord our God hath commanded you? Then thou shalt say unto thy son, We are Pharaoh's bondmen in Egypt, and the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And the Lord showed signs and wonders, great and slow, upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh, and upon all his household before our eyes. And he brought us out from thence, that he might bring us in to give us the land which he swore unto our fathers. And the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God, for our good always, that he might preserve us alive, as it is that city, it is that this city, and it shall be our righteousness, if we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God, as he hath commanded us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the psalm. The psalm for today is Psalm 25, which can be found in page 369 of the Book of Common Prayer, verses 1 through 13. Psalm 25. Unto thee, O Lord, will I lift up my soul. My God, I have put my trust in thee.
Let me not be confounded, let my soul be quiet over me.
For all they that hope in thee shall not be ashamed.
Such as transgression of God shall be put in thee.
Show me thy ways, O Lord.
Teach me thy paths.
Lead me forth in thy truth and learn me.
Thou art God my salvation. Thee am I.
Call to remembrance, O Lord, thy tender mercies,
and thy loving kindnesses which have ever been of old.
Remember not the sins and the offenses of my youth.
But according to thy mercy, hang thou upon me, O Lord, for thy goodness.
Gracious and righteous is the Lord.
Therefore will he teach us sins well.
Then that our meek shall be guided in judgment.
Such as are gentle, them shall be delivered.
All the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth.
And such as he is covenant and his testimonies.
For thy name's sake, O Lord,
be merciful to my sin, for it is great.
What man is he that feared the Lord?
Him shall he teach the way that he shall choose.
His soul shall dwell as these.
And his seed shall inherit the land.
The secret of the Lord is among them that fear him.
He will show them his covenant.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be, world without end. Amen.
The lesson for the epistle is from the Blessed Apostle Paul, letter to the Ephesians, in the 5th chapter, beginning at the 1st verse. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also had loved us, and had given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savour. But fornication and uncleanness of covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, no unclean person, no covetous man, who is an idolater, hath any inheritance of the kingdom of Christ our God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them, for ye were sometimes darkness, but now are the ye, know that ye, like in the Lord, walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord, and have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light of whatsoever doth make manifest in light. Wherefore, he said, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. Get in the epistle.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the gospel.
The graduate hymn is hymn number 59. Hymn number 59.
Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Jesus was casting out a devil, and it was done. And it came to pass when the devil was gone out, the dumb spoke. And the people wondered, but some of them said, he casteth out devils through Beelzebub, the chief of the devils. And others tending him sought of him a sign from heaven. But he, knowing their thoughts, said unto them, every kingdom divided against itself is brought to this and a house divided against a house fall? If Satan also be divided against himself, how shall this kingdom stand? Because he say that I cast out devils through Beelzebub. But if I be Beelzebub, cast out devils, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore shall they be your judges. But if I with the finger of God cast out devils, no doubt the kingdom of God has come upon you. When a strong man armed keepeth his palace, his goods are in peace. But when a stronger than he shall come upon him and overcome him, he taketh from him all his armor wherein he trusted, and divideth his spoils. He that is not with me is against me, and he that gathereth not with me scattereth. When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man, he walketh in dry places, seeking rest and finding none. He saith, I will return unto my house once I came out. And when he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished. Then goeth he and taketh to him seven other spirits, more wicked than himself. And they entered in and dwell therein. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. And it came to pass, as he spake these things, a certain woman of the company lifted up her voice and said unto him, Blessed is the womb that bare thee, and the paps which thou hast sucked. But he said, Yea, rather, blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. First of all, I want to say thank you to Vaughn and to Linda for covering the services on Wednesday night. I heard that they were really beautifully done, and I really appreciate their doing that. It gave the four of us a chance to go up to a clericus with the bishop and all the other clergy of the diocese. The clericus is a time of prayer and teaching and training for your ministers, though it doesn't look like it this morning. It was a very successful, and it was a really moving time up there. So I really believe that time that we spent will make all of us better priests, and and bring us closer together, both as clergy and as shepherds for this flock. So I'm really appreciative, and it was a very, very good clericus. We have coming up this coming Wednesday, we have our regular services the way that we have been having them. It'll be the Eucharist at 6 o'clock, followed by Stations of the Cross, and followed by the Bible study. And I believe that it is Father Chet that is going to finish up the Epistle to Titus. Next Saturday, we have our patronal feast, and that's St. Patrick's. So we'll be cooking corned beef and cabbage. Carolyn, do you want to talk about getting prepared for the corned beef and cabbage dinner?
Sure. We did have donations of corned beef in the freezer. If anyone else is planning to purchase corned beef, would you let them know after church today? Because I'm going to have to pick up the slack with church funds. We're going to meet Friday, noonish, in the kitchen to peel potatoes and carrots and chop up the cabbage to be ready for Saturday.
Thank you. Saturday morning, we'll have our regular work day. But before I talk about the regular work day, there's been some irregular work that's been done. I know that Mark and Jeff were in the Memorial Garden this week, that we've had Leah and Andrea and Greg working on the parish hall. I said Mark.
Yes.
Okay. And so thank you all for the preparation work. And then this is our last opportunity to get everything ready for Easter, which is coming up very fast. We're a third of the way through Lent already. By next week, we'll be more than a halfway through Lent already. The bishop is going to join us on the Sunday following our St. Patrick's Day supper. He's going to do the Mass. It's going to be a sung high Mass, which is a little different than we normally do. So I'm going to have Linda get together with Father Robert to work a little bit on the bulletin so everybody knows what's going on. It's more prayers, but all the prayers that we always do. And he'll sing part of it. So it's very nice. And Leah, I'll have Father Robert get together with you on the parts of the service that he wants us to sing. And I think, the next day is also Ladies to Lunch. And we're going to make a change for Ladies to Lunch because the bishop is likely going to join us. And if they go all the way back to COPA.
Today's Gospel, our Lord Jesus Christ, brings forward teachings that will ultimately define either the eternal bliss in paradise with Jesus Christ of the eternal torment with Satan of those who reject his word. In the gospel, Jesus enters into another of the many running conflicts he has had with religious leaders of Israel. As the gospels portrayed Jesus' ministry, the scribes, Pharisees, and Sadducees initially follow him about with an attitude of curiosity. But as Jesus' popularity with the people grows, the religious establishment commits itself more and more to opposing Jesus. They began to worry that the teachings of Jesus will jeopardize their positions of power and respect. The incident described here by Luke presents a disturbing question to those who watched what happened, and that applies to us today. That question, quite simply, is this. If Jesus is who he says he is, then what does it call for me to do? The spark that ignited this particular confrontation was a miraculous act of mercy and love by our Lord, and I quote, "And he was casting out a devil, and it was dumb. And it came to pass, when the devil was gone out, that the dumb spake, and the people wondered. But some of them said, he casts out devils through Beelzebub, the chief of the devils." Luke reports that there were some religious leaders in the crowd monitoring all that Jesus said or did. In their gospels, both Matthew and Mark identified Jesus' opponents as Pharisees and scribes. Those religious leaders responded to this miraculous action on the part of Jesus by claiming that it was accomplished by the power of the devil. This healing, this miraculous act of mercy, is met with amazement from the crowd. The religious leaders needed to vilify Jesus, to shame him. They determined to prove that Jesus exorcised this demon by the power of Satan, and they demand more evidence, hoping to shame Jesus as a fraud. The Lord says quite clearly that this accusation, that he is the devil's service, healing, preaching, and exorcising demons, is Jesus responded, "And by whose power do your sons exorcise demons? Are they in league with Satan too?" And thereby Jesus exposes their hypocrisy. To further his point, the Lord points to something everyone would understand, how a thief cannot openly plunder another man's house unless he is stronger than the man he is robbing. In this short parable, Satan is the householder, and Jesus is the man coming to plunder his house. The point should be obvious. Since Jesus is spoiling the devil's kingdom, he can't be Satan's lesser minion. He must be stronger than the devil. Thus far, Jesus has answered with the wiggle room, no way to avoid making a change. Excuse me. With no wiggle room, no way to avoid making a choice. He openly challenged them, and Jesus shares with us today an unforgettable phrase, "He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters." This is what we study in Scripture. This is the choice we are offered every day. The image that this brings up is that of a shepherd and his flock. Jesus came to gather together the scattered tribes of Israel and of the Gentiles. His mission is to bring together humankind that has been scattered by sin and human lies. He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters. These are the options that Jesus has put forward for us. There's not a lot of gray area in these words, and as a result, people who are sitting on that fence will either fall on God's side or on Satan's side. There's no middle ground, and this still applies to us today. Jesus has come to heal, to teach, to gather sinners into the flock of true believers. Every action of Jesus Christ is directed toward those ends. We must open our hearts and minds to listen, to accept his words, and live our lives following the teachings of Jesus. The members of this crowd in our gospel today that were most noticed were those people who would stand in judgment of Jesus, the Pharisees and scribes. Those who suppose they can appear to maintain a stance of neutrality, that they have little wiggle room, while they rendered a predetermined verdict on whether or not Jesus is credible. Jesus explains that a man who has exorcised an evil spirit must fill that vacuum with God, or will be refilled with even more evil spirits. And so there is another member of the audience here who often goes overlooked, the man from whom the demon was expelled. Perhaps it was to this man that Jesus directed his warning. The warning about the demon departing and then returning to bring seven more devils with him. The point is this, if we have been rescued, if we have been ransomed, if Jesus has flooded Satan's household and claimed you and me for himself, we will find ourselves, whether we want to or not, to be combatants in a war between Jesus and Satan. And the mandate for us is simple and straightforward. In Ephesians 5, we're told, therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ has also loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. This was Jesus' word to the crowd, and particularly to the demon-possessed man whom Jesus had freed from the spiritual bondage. A woman in the crowd called out, blessed is the womb that beareth thee, and the paps which thou hast sucked. And as our gospel ends, Jesus replies, yea, rather, blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it. People may choose either eternal bliss in paradise with Jesus Christ or the eternal torment with Satan for those who reject his word. He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters. There is no wiggle room. There is no other choice. I pray that we may all hear the words of the gospel today and keep the love and teachings of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in our hearts unto everlasting life in paradise with him. Praise be to God.
Amen.
Let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven.
inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people, give thy heavenly grace, especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Especially we pray for Jeanette, Tracy, Jim, Joe, Mike, Bobby, Lily, Naomi, Don, Chuck, John, Mandy, Charlene, Diane, Pat, Yvonne, Peggy, Abigail, Father Tim, Father Greg, Father Frank, Bishop John, Johnny, Father Chet, Bobby, Emmy, Dr. Ken, Penton, Wayne, Elaine, Mike, Ellen, Melanie, Butch, Lindsay, Jack, Harold, Heidi, Joyce, Tom, Sally, Rhonda, Raymond, Grace, Jerry, Mike, Carrie, Ariel, Marjorie, Gina, Marion, McComas family, Tiffany, Emily, and Dennis. For those traveling, Marie, Sandy, and Tyler. And for those serving in our military, Jason, Sage, Johnny, Catherine, Greg, Kendall, Andrew, Michael, Corey, Haley, Dean, Julie, Kyle, Naomi, James, and Jacob. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear. But especially we pray for Paul, Herbie, Alice, Martha, Kevin, Iman, Elaine, Dave, and in loving memory of Bud Black. We beseech you need to grant them continued growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace unto follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
Do you truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and our love and charity with your neighbor, and tend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession unto Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and
words our Savior Christ said unto all who truly turn unto him. Come unto me, all ye who travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the end, that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Here also what St. Paul said, this is a true saying, and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Here also what St. John said, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right, so
it is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all time and in all places give thanks unto thee, the Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord most high. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord, O Son, and in the highest. All glory be unto thee, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, for that thou of thy tender mercy to give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself, once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. In the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, we, thy humble servants, to celebrate, make here before thy divine majesty, with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks, the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. We most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we, and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion, may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ,
be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and make one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit,
behold,
which is the blessed company of all faithful people. There are also heirs of most of us here. That is important to him. We're going to give him another birthday blessing. Watch over thy child, Father Robert, O Lord, as his days increase. Bless and guide him wherever he may be. Keep him unspotted from the world. Strengthen him when he stands. Comfort him when he is discouraged or sorrowful. Raise him up if he falls. And in his heart, may the peace which passes all understanding abide all the days of his life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
So, as Christians, we don't give spankings. We do share the blessing of laying on of hands. So when you see Father, we put your hand on his shoulder and wish him a blessed birthday. Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
The Mass is ended. Go forward in peace and love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Sessional hymn is hymn number 61. 61.